great pleasure of introducing Marina Gottlieb-Sarles, but first I want to say a few thank yous to Dennis Babichak and Stephen of East Hampton Library, who helped us coordinate this today, and to Christine Matei, who has brought us back to the Hamptons once again. My name is Kim Nagy. I am the co-founder of Wild River Publishing, where our mission is to tell stories that elevate our understanding of the human condition through the power of language, stories, art, and finely crafted books, and all multimedia. The award-winning book, because I should let you know, Marina just won a global award for The Last Daughter of Prussia, is a moving love story set in the most chilling areas of history, World War II and the Holocaust. Author Marina Gottlieb-Sarles is a born storyteller who grew up on an island in the Bahamas to German parents who escaped Nazi Germany. And as she spent summers swimming with dolphins and observing wild horses in the bush, she also imagined the Europe her parents left behind. Sarles worked as a practicing physical therapist for 20 years before she wrote her first collection of short stories called Sand in My Shoes about island life. ESPN produced a special feature on her stories, and she's also been published by Macmillan. And I should let you know also, recently Marina published a feature article in the Philadelphia Inquirer about the importance of honoring all of the lives lost during the Holocaust, during National Holocaust Awareness Month. The Last Daughter of Prussia has been praised by Publishers Weekly as keenly felt and vivid. And again, it's my great honor to introduce Marina Gottlieb-Sarles, who dares to tell stories that haven't been told about the Holocaust and World War II. Including the story of the Great Trek in World War II, which very few people know about and which we'll talk about more in a few moments, the forgotten Holocaust of the Romani Gypsies, so many women who were tragically raped during World War II as a tool of war, and finally, last but not least, the Trikaner horses who saved so many lives. So without further ado, I'd like to hand over the floor to Marina Gottlieb-Sarles. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. And I know you trekked from Connecticut, right?
Right.
And your beautiful faith, thank you. And so I'm here to just start to tell you a little bit about this book. I want to thank you too, Stephen, and I want to, on YouTube, thank Dennis for getting me here and having me here, and all of you for coming on this beautiful Saturday afternoon. So I'm going to start just to tell you a little bit about why and how this book came to be. The Last Daughter of Prussia, and I've got to do this here, so I'm going to move this.
I can do it.
The Last Daughter of Prussia is a historical novel that uncovers the untold and harrowing escape of the so-called Great Trek out of East Prussia. This is a picture of the Great Trek right at the end of World War II. It happened in the bitterest winter of 44-45, when the Russian army was invading. And the Russians came with a vengeance for all that Hitler had done in their country. They were really pretty unmerciful. They came with orders to kill pretty much anything that was German: women, children, horses, animals. This trek was the largest mass exodus in history, and it is also the one that is least talked about. 500,000 people died on this trek, and when the Russians came in, they often came, when they took the women, they would say "Ukaz Stalin," which means orders of Stalin. And almost, they think, it's that 3 million women were raped, many of them to death by entire battalions. My grandparents, I just want to say, you know, that they left East Prussia when this trek was out of East Prussia, and I wanted to show you this so you have an idea, because many people today don't even know where East Prussia was. They don't even know that it existed, because it's a land that vanished.
Caitlin, could you come to the next, please?
You see here this small province. The main part of Germany was over to the west. That's Lithuania, the Soviet Union, Belarusia, and Poland. So when the Russians came through, this little province, which had probably been untouched mostly until that time, was the first place that the Russians put their boots on. And they came, as I said before, with a intention to retaliate, and they did. Until that time, I wanted to also say that my grandparents were on that trek. These are my grandparents, and they were on that trek, and I wrote this story for them. I wrote this story for the millions of East Prussians. We have one here amongst us, Ed, who experienced the unspeakable horrors of war, and who felt that because they were German, they had no right to speak. Many of the women who were raped did not speak about the rapes. Rape is such a tool of war, and such a demoralizing tool of war. It really takes the women away from the men. And the men, there were so many women who didn't even tell their husbands or their partners that this had happened to them. So I really wanted to write for these people and give them a voice, because they've gone to their graves holding this taboo in their bones. Women like these women were raped. We're talking about grandmothers, because most of the men had been drafted and taken to the front. So grandmothers, young girls, young boys, through the ranks, they were raped. And I just felt that this is something that needed to be told, because you can't take this in your lineage onwards, these wounds. And so I felt this intense desire to write about what had happened. It wasn't an easy book to write, believe me. The research was very difficult. Until, as I said before, until that time when the Russians came through, East Prussia had been mostly untouched. It looked pretty much like this. I put this slide up there because that is the estate of my grandfather and grandmother before the war. That is Guja. For anyone who has read the book, you know about Guja. And my grandparents lived on an estate called Guja, and that's what it looked like pretty much before the Russians came through. I've been there since, and it is still standing, but totally in shambles now. The walls are still there, but it's really broken down. What's so unfortunate about this piece of history is that Hitler knew what was coming. He really knew. And he could have, in the months before the Russians broke through the borders, he could have evacuated the people. And they were civilians. We're talking, I'm not saying that there weren't Nazis amongst the East Prussians. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying, like those old women you saw there and people like that, they could have gotten out. But he refused to let them go. He basically used them as human shields in my eyes, and he didn't want to show that there was any weakness. He wanted to sort of keep them there and say, you know, we're not leaving. What happened then was that the East Prussian people, when they finally realized that the Russians were on their doorstep, many of them defied his orders and they left. The problem with defying Hitler at that point was that he had also given orders that people who fled could be shot as traitors. So these people were stuck in between Hitler time they decided to flee, it was too late. And there was only one escape route open, which I will show you here. This is the Frisches Haff. It's a small little body of water which is connected to the Baltic Sea, and it was frozen. And it was pitted with bombs and craters because the Russians shot holes into the ice so that the civilians going across would fall to their deaths. But this little piece of frozen lagoon was the only escape route open. And at this time, this late. And they had to get to the Nerum, this small spit of land you see here, which they hoped would take them westward to ports like Danzig, so they could get out on ships. And many of them did not make it. You know, many of them died on that little strip of land. This is Guja, which really still exists today. When you look at the map of Poland, these names have all been changed except for Guja. I went there and Guja still is Guja. But this is the map, so you see where they were. By that time, the Russians were also in Elbing, in Königsberg, which is up there. And they just managed to get across, and many did not. As the roads leading up to this small frozen lagoon were rutted and pitted, the only way these people could actually get out was over fields. And when I want to say the roads were also jam-packed with fleeing refugees and army vehicles. At that time, many of the Nazis were even just fleeing. They knew what was coming, and they jam-packed the roads with their own vehicles. And so many of the refugees had to go over land. And the only way they could do it was with their horses. So they hitched their wagons to these beautiful Turkana horses. At that time, there were many people who weren't even sure that the Turkanas would be able to withstand what was coming. But these amazing horses are really, in my eyes, the true heroes of the trek, because they took these people in these wagons. You can see they're just loaded with people and their cherished possessions. And they took them through artillery zones, through bombings, and took them as far as they could across this Frisches Haff and then to the Nerum and then hopefully to ports like Danzig. The Turkaners go to this. This is a stallion named Fetis Ox, and he was one of the most important stallions in the Turkaner line. I don't know if you've ever heard of the Turkaners, but they are the oldest warm blood breed of horses today. They are over 200 years old. They were bred in Turkanen, an amazing farm, stud farm, which was created by Kaiser Wilhelm I and II. And they had this enormous stud farm that was just for the most beautiful horses, and the lineage was kept incredibly clear. So Fetis Ox is a stallion whose dressage line today still is very important. Most of his descendants, they are winners in the World Cups for dressage. And he was my inspiration, I will say that right here. When I was researching, I'll just go off a little here, deviate a tiny bit. When I was researching, I sometimes say, you know, the Prussians, they have this, they have Juwilheit, you know, they were very Prussian. And I got these dreams, and I just kept thinking, what are these dreams about? And I kept hearing in these dreams, you must write, Juwilheit. And I didn't know what to write about, but I said, well, tell me what to write about. And it was almost like, you know, you got to research it yourself. So one morning at 3 a.m, I went down to the computer. I don't know what I put in, but I think I put something in about East Prussia, about my mother's land. And this was the first horse that came up. And when I read about him, I was so shocked to know that the Russians had slaughtered him. They shot him in cold blood, because they were told that anything German, anything beautiful, kill it. And for me, he is the in a way, the symbol of what these people went through. This breed almost vanished. Many of these horses were just shot and slaughtered and eaten, or they died of starvation. The East Prussian people went through the same thing. They were shot or slaughtered, and they lost something. They lost these, the horses almost lost the breed, but the East Prussian people lost their land. East Prussia no longer exists. It is now